This video is brought to you by CuriosityStream. Get access to CuriosityStream and my streaming service Nebula and watch my Nebula exclusive video Debater Theater at curiositystream.com/sarahzed. A Twitter user tells another Twitter user that they like the idea of supernatural characters Dean Winchester and Castiel getting together. Their conversational partner says, "Just say you support pseudo-incest then." A few months later, another Twitter user makes a comic saying they wished more stories explored dark themes with nuance and complexity. Someone responds, calling them a sanctimonious little twerp with unexamined disgust, obsessed with bringing up the exploitation of children. One Twitter user says they dislike the story trope of someone falling in love with the child they raised as soon as that child becomes an adult. Someone replies, "Just say you can't distinguish fiction from reality." How did we get here? There's been a lot of talk of ships on this channel. It's a large, unavoidable part of internet culture, and as a result, a large part of the content here. Whether that's stuff like John Locke, Destiel, Oncest, Team Edward, Zutara, Rosemary, Cabbage Man and his cabbages, we've talked about a lot of ships of various different types. And with all of these is an undercurrent of something more, something beyond just the basic aspect of pairing two characters together. Because no matter how simple a fictional character pairing may seem, the truth is that it is almost never that simple. There is almost always going to be discourse of some kind, be it because people find the ship offensive, because they find it unappealing, or because they don't like the people doing the ship itself. And soon what happens is that the very basic concept of shipping two characters becomes the breeding ground for something deeper and darker and messier. It brings you into the world of pro-shippers and aunties. So what are pro-shippers and aunties? That's somehow both a very simple and very complex question. There isn't one universally agreed upon definition of either term, and this is especially problematic when it comes to auntie. It's a very weird term because, like, linguistically speaking, it's a prefix, like auntie what? The reason behind that is that auntie is often a generalized term in a bunch of fandoms that serves generally the same linguistic purpose as the word hater would. So for example, if you're a fan of a specific K-pop group, like say Luna, bloggers who really hate that group and post negative things about them could be called Luna aunties. I remember the first time I encountered the term auntie was in reference to the serial killer fandom on Tumblr, which is a story for another time, but is exactly what it sounds like. People who made posts opposing this fandom's existence got called aunties. What that means is that auntie can be taken to mean a person who opposes pretty much anything, be it good, bad, or neutral, making it a very confusing term in online spaces. With regards to shipping spaces specifically, the labels pro-shipper and anti tend to represent a broad nexus of fandom culture war positions. The least contested definition I can possibly think of for these terms is that a pro-shipper is someone who generally supports the creation and consumption of quote-unquote problematic shipping content pairing fictional characters together, while an anti is someone who generally opposes this. What is and isn't considered problematic is, of course, not something universally agreed upon, and so the term can therefore mean anything from enemies to lovers fanfiction to, like, people pairing Sans Undertale with Frisk Undertale, who's like 8. It's a broad spectrum. But again, the vagueness of terms like anti still makes them pretty hard to define. Like, what does it actually mean to support these pairings? Does it mean you ship them yourself? Does it mean you like them? Does it mean you actively dislike them but simply don't oppose them? Or does it mean that you actively dislike them and believe they're morally wrong but keep your opinion to yourself and won't harass someone else for liking them? For that matter, what does it even mean mean to ship two characters. Some people use the term to essentially mean thinking that a romantic relationship between two characters is a good thing, whereas other people might use the term to just mean that they want to see the relationship on screen. And you know, sometimes we want to see things on screen that aren't good or healthy for the characters involved. I don't go to a horror movie to see good and happy things happen to the characters. I go to a horror movie knowing and wanting to see things happen to the characters that are bad. But if you're a person who takes "I ship this" to mean "I think this is a good couple" rather than "I want to see this happen in the story," well, you can see where people's wires might get crossed. Individual people might have their own answers to all of these gray areas, but the lack of a formalized group consensus means that two people might have the exact same beliefs on the subject, but merely label themselves differently as a matter of semantics and thus hate each other. Take me, for example. I don't personally ship Rey Star Wars and Kylo Star Wars with each other. I don't like Kylo and I don't like the ship. I've made fun of fictional character Kylo Ren on the internet a few times, although I don't think I've made fun of the ship specifically. At the same time, I don't particularly care if anyone else ships it. I don't seek out content for it, and if someone else likes it, that doesn't really matter to me. I don't like it, but it's fine if someone else does. It's whatever. Does that make me a pro-shipper for Reylo or an anti-Reylo? I literally don't know, because theoretically my "it doesn't bother me if someone else ships this" stance is consistent with the pro-shipper position, but I've regularly seen myself get labeled as anti-Reylo for the fact that I don't personally like the ship. I remember one time I made a tweet like, "I don't really think Kylo Ren and Zuko are as similar as people think," and literally got hundreds of absolutely unhinged responses saying I was harassing them and was therefore an anti-Reylo. The tweet did not mention Rey at all. It was just about Kylo Ren. It still baffles me. It still baffles me to this fucking day. This is just one example of the phenomenon, but it's a pretty good demonstration of how even a basic definition like supports or opposes problematic ships leaves a lot of wiggle room and makes the labels very confusing. That's not the only reason this is the case, and I'll talk more about why I think this is just a bad framework and how it ends up equating a broad range of issues of varying seriousness later, but if you're clicking just to hear me tell you whether I'm a pro-shipper or an anti, you'll have to be satisfied with the response that I am a tax-paying adult woman, not a member of a fucking fandom war sports team. That being said, despite the labels of pro-shipper and anti ostensibly just being about shipping by virtue of their name, these labels tend to be more encompassing than they sound. That is to say, debates between pro-shippers and antis tend to not just be about ships themselves, but about all manner of creative content and fan spaces that could be termed problematic for some reason or another. This could include RPF, that is to say, fan fiction written about real people, often band members, athletes, or YouTubers, which is contentious in general, but especially when it features creators who are underage or when it veers into the territory of NSFW fan fiction. It can include things like how villainous characters are treated in a specific narrative, even in the absence of a particular ship. It also includes the treatment of underage fictional characters in general, which again can range from debates over like whether it's okay to have a sex scene between two teenage characters to like very explicit art or fanfiction about characters who are little kids. I'm sure you can already see how dividing this entire issue about fan spaces into red team and blue team is suboptimal and can very quickly lean into equating those two things. The pro-shipper narrative is usually just that they're minding their own business, trying to exist and do their own thing, but that antis, whom they also sometimes refer to as fan cops, keep coming into their own spaces and harassing them for the art that they make and the shows that they like. Conversely, the anti-narrative tends to be that they're also minding their own business and doing their own thing, but that the preponderance of various flavors of problematic fan works makes fan spaces actively hostile to exist in or just actively worse. Generally speaking, the underlying idea behind the anti-mindset is that fiction has some kind of impact upon reality, or at the very least, that we can make moral critiques of fiction. This tends to manifest itself in one of two ways. There's the consequentialist approach, which suggests that there are direct negative consequences that emerge from the creation and consumption of problematic fan material. Let me again restate that I think anti and pro-shipper are bad labels, which I'll I'll elaborate more on later, but part of that is, of course, that problematic fan material can mean all manner of varying things, upon which we actually are allowed to have differing opinions beyond having all our views sorted into two camps. Nevertheless, let's just stick with this framing for now. So, this consequentialist approach might suggest, for example, that not safe for work fanfiction or fan art about two underage characters might be used to harm real children, or that fanfiction about real people might harm their relationships between each other if it gets spread around. Generally speaking, proponents of this consequentialist approach can point to examples of works of fiction that have had some kind of direct impact on the real world. The most common example given in these argument spaces is the impact that the movie Jaws had on stoking mass fears of shark attacks and thus encouraging real-life cullings of shark populations. There's also the principled approach, which is to say that even where these works don't directly lead to other utilitarian harms, they can be, in and of themselves, just morally bad. If this is confusing to you, one common example that illustrates the limits of consequentialist thinking is the example of cheating on your partner and getting away with it. The idea is that even if you did not cause any direct harm to your partner, they never found out about it, it never harmed your relationship, etc., we would still generally consider cheating on your partner to be an innately morally wrong thing to do, even in the absence of direct harm being caused to any one person. So, as applied to antis, an anti might believe that even where a real person doesn't see the fanfiction you published about them, publishing explicit fanfiction about real people is just still an innately morally wrong thing to do. Or that horny frisk fan art, even when it doesn't traumatize someone or get shown to a real child, is still, in and of itself, morally wrong to create. This argument is particularly common when it comes to not people who create quote-unquote problematic art, but instead the people who host it. The existence of popular fanfiction platform Archive of Our Own, or AO3, has become somewhat of a battleground between pro-shippers and antis, with antis frustrated that the platform has virtually no moderation standards against problematic work, ranging all the way from things like RPF to even like hate speech or even just spam. There was one particular incident that was pretty big a few months ago where there was this fanfiction that had like this massive list of tags, and it seemed to just solely exist to like clog up the website for people, and it was tags upon tags upon tags, and people were clamoring for AO3 to like do something and moderate, and finally eventually they responded to it by letting you block works from specific creators. But it was kind of a good example of where AO3 is like, no, we need to be a free and open space, versus people's like, no, this is making the website actively worse, kind of come together. So meanwhile, pro shippers tend to be particularly defensive of the site, excited that a mostly unmoderated space that promotes creative freedom exists, especially for those who have existed in fan spaces like LiveJournal or even just fanfiction.net, where explicit works are often banned and or purged. The pro shipper argument tends to be based on a few general principles. The first is, simply put, fiction is not reality. This argument contests the impact that fictional works can have on reality, typically asserting that pieces of fiction either have no impact on the real world or that their impact is negligible. Generally speaking, people will argue that fiction reflects the real world rather than influences it, and that therefore there are very few, if any, real harms that come from people making, say, romantic fan content about toxic relationships. The second primary pro-shipper argument posits that people are generally responsible for their own consumption of content online. This is especially touted in response to arguments about AO3. The idea is that because these platforms require you to seek out problematic art, you are implicitly consenting to seeing that kind of art, and as a result, you are by and large solely responsible if that art supposedly harms you. Basically, if you clicked on a fanfiction where siblings get together, you can't therefore claim to be harmed by reading a fanfiction where siblings get together because you know what you signed up for. Dead dove do not eat.
I don't know what I expected.
Both this and fiction is not reality tend to be touted in response to the consequentialist argument from antis and not the argument of innate morality. These points don't directly address whether problematic fan content can be morally good or bad in and of themselves, rather just focusing on their real-world impact. But of course, there's still kind of that implicit claim that problematic ships don't hold any innate moral weight. The final argument tends to focus generally on creative freedom as an innate good. Oftentimes, this takes the form of comparing antis to a variety of historical pro-censorship movements, or simply noting that the type of art antis oppose can be the same kind of art that's historically been censored. And indeed, there is historical precedent for literature considered trash or smut to be banned or burned in a variety of contexts. The idea here is that the ability for people to write whatever they want, draw whatever they want, ship whatever they want, and publish whatever they want online is innately good, and that trying to take that away is dangerous. Both of these in-groups have their own internal conflicts over the boundaries of their own identities from time to time, which I'll get more into later, and they also tend to have their own like slang, aesthetics, and stereotypes about what each group looks like. For example, the ant emoji is pretty commonly used to refer to antis in pro-shipper spheres on Twitter, and this particular combination of emojis right here, rainbow meat, is often used to denote pro-shippers. Rainbow meat originated from the Hannibal fandom, a show known for its toxic and fascinating relationship between villain cannibal Hannibal and criminal profiler Will Graham, whom Hannibal takes on as his patient. It's basically a way of denoting both queerness and pro-shipperness. Besides things like slang and emoji codes, there are also general perceptions about who tends to belong to each group. The general understanding of these issues is that antis tend to be teenagers and pro-shippers tend to be adults. This isn't necessarily always actually true, but it's more so that this is how the issue tends to be perceived in these fan spaces. As a result, a lot of pro-shipper circles tend to include a kind of performative hatred for teenagers and also just children in general. A common insult towards so-called antis is calling them puriteens, which I'll at least give them credit for a very good pun. Lots of times, arguments between pro-shippers and antis include some kind of line about how no one is parenting the youth these days and how back in my day we had to walk up to LiveJournal to get our fan content, uphill both ways, in the snow. This one particularly memorable tweet on the subject referred to antis as, and I quote, little minor shit beasts. A general axiom in these circles is that a lot of pro-shippers are women who resent the expectation that they have to be maternal or looking out for children, and so they will often very emphatically state that they have no responsibility to look out for the well-being of kids online, or at the very least, make their own fandom spaces child-friendly. Once again, this can range from simple statements like, you know, adults deserve to have their own spaces online where they don't have to make child-friendly content, all the way to statements like, if you're a child and you see something online that's not child-friendly, that's your own fault and you should get over it. Conversely, fandom mom tends to be a derisive term that antis use against pro-shippers. It's not just a thing in pro-shipper and anti-circles, but it did gain a lot of prominence there and tends to refer to an adult woman in fandom who designates herself as some kind of trustworthy authority figure on fandom matters, cultivates an audience of young fans, and then interacts with that audience in some kind of inappropriate way, often by either being creepy or just spending a lot of time arguing with teens online. Blossom from my TJLC video, who I believe actually self-identified as a fandom mom, might be an example of this.
This is quite literally the stupidest, pettiest load of pedantic drivel directed to killing the fun and happiness of kids enjoying themselves on the internet that I've ever read in my life.
As a result, you'll of course get a lot of arguments as to whether this is a useful term or whether it's simply ageist and sexist toward adult women. We also see a lot of arguments online in these spaces that are framed as being minors versus adults, and although that's not necessarily fully accurate, that tends to to be the dominant perception surrounding pro-shippers and anties. As I'm sure you can already tell by now, the whole thing is very messy, and the division of pro-shipper and anti into these two distinct labels pretty much ensures that the whole thing remains an eternal posting war. And I'm gonna tell you more about what that all looks like, provide more critiques of the whole phenomenon, and analyze where this largely comes from, but first I need to establish to you how absolutely nuts this shipping war has gotten. And in order to do that, I need to tell you a story. It's the story of how an offhanded tweet I made led to a site-wide controversy and also led to me directly influencing Hannibal showrunner Brian Fuller's clothing purchases. And okay, this is going to be a bit nuts, but I promise you this is not just gonna be like a people were mean to me on Twitter video. I think that this is an important thing to share for like disclosure and contextualization and just because it's fucking buck wild, but rest assured, this entire video is not just going to be a recap of some Twitter drama. Please bear with me here. So, okay. This past March 14th, a writer on Twitter made this post that ended up going viral with nearly 300,000 likes and 40,000 retweets. That's likes, not views, so this thing was probably read like millions of times. Basically, the tweet consists of two screenshots of someone with a censored username messaging the original poster saying, "You need to explain to me why you ship these two anime characters when they're both underage, and why you like Hannibal when I'm personally uncomfortable with the Hannibal fandom." The OP asks how old they are, the Anon says they're 15, and the OP is like, "Well, I don't want to argue with a teenager," the 15-year-old calls them an old bitch, and the writer replies with, "Be gone, tot." This conversation was posted with the caption, "Kids on this bird app are getting real bold." It ended up, as I said, getting massive levels of engagement with thousands upon thousands of quote tweets and replies, most of them that I could find in support of this person, talking about how hilariously clever "Be Gone, Tot" is, talking about how the kid is too young to be watching Hannibal anyway, and generally just talking about how much they hate children. There are also definitely people in the replies getting mad at the original poster, and those mostly take the form of doubting that the exchange depicted in the screenshot actually happened. Now, as you know, if you've seen one of my videos, I've done a lot of research into fake stories online and the way that they can be used to generate backlash against various marginalized groups. I did a whole video about how one single guy's fake story posts on Reddit were a huge contributing factor to a lot of anti-social justice rhetoric back in the mid-2010s. I've had to look at a lot of these things, and when I saw this exchange, it was definitely setting off alarm bells for a fake post. A lot of the little elements in it just felt too on the nose as a parody to be entirely real. For example, censoring the word "horny" in a DM for absolutely no reason, which just doesn't make sense. Generally, the reason you would censor the name of a word or a ship in a social media post would be for one of two reasons. Either so that other people can't search for the word and get mad at you, or so that on a platform like YouTube or TikTok, your post won't automatically get detected or blocked by filters. Neither of these apply here, so it seems less like this was an actual conversation between two real people and more like it was somebody parodying the writing style of one of these kids. Things like that and weird dialogue choices like "I'm a minor, but I'm 15" led me to feel like this whole exchange is setting up to the punchline of "Be Gone, Tot." And the whole thing just bears a lot of resemblance to other posts online that have been confirmed to be fake. There's that famous one about a teenage girl who yells at an adult woman in public because she somehow knew the woman shipped Rey and Kylo Ren from Star Wars, and she then got chewed out by her mom, who also shipped Reylo. It really gives off that same energy. Now, I could be completely wrong on this, but to me, this just sets off a lot of alarm bells for fake posts online. The second thought I had was, if this is real, it's kind of, I don't know, a bit childish. It just seems kind of juvenile to be a grown adult proudly publishing screen caps of yourself dunking on children to get validation from other adults who are like, "Yeah, you go. You tell off that child. Like, yeah, congratulations. You had a witty retort to a literal child and are now getting hundreds of thousands of people praising you for your epic child dunking. Middle schooler destroyed with facts and logic. And that's not to say that if this exchange is real, which I'm suspicious of, the hypothetical child did nothing wrong here. The middle schooler made a shitty comment, which they shouldn't have made. But I also think if you're an adult who proudly revels in your ability to dunk on said child, not just in responding to the messages, but specifically in like posting it online, that reflects kind of poorly on you as a grown-up person. It just feels immature and like you probably should have just blocked them. Like, even before the exchange got heated, if you see a 15-year-old messaging you asking you to justify your fandoms to them, you should probably just block them. So I saw this tweet, which was massively popular and was, as far as I could see at the time that I was responding to it, receiving near universal acclaim. It's since gotten more disagreement, but at the time I was reading this hugely viral tweet and scrolling through all these supportive replies, and the whole thing felt so nuts to me. So I had said, "Provided this is even real, why even bother responding to an actual child to get into an argument and dunk on them? It's a child, just go do something else, they can't hurt you." And then, maybe Tyler the Creator was right about cyberbullying, but only very specifically in the context of adults who forego the block tool in favor of regularly arguing with and feeling aggressively threatened by random middle schoolers. Mind you, if you disagree with this opinion, that's totally fair and I get it. I can see why someone would feel a different way about it. I think there's a conversation to be had about the kinds of responsibilities we all have online, and I got some responses simply saying they disagreed with me, which is totally cool. But what could have been a simple difference of opinion got pretty nuts pretty quickly on Twitter because it's Twitter. Firstly, I was getting a lot of replies referring to events that very much were not present in that original tweet exchange. Like this one, essentially saying, "So we're just supposed to ignore this horrible thing and this horrible thing and this horrible thing if a child does it," which, no. That's not what I said. None of those examples had anything to do with the exchange depicted in the tweet. I got a whole bunch of replies like that, essentially boiling down to the fandom drama equivalent of, "Well, what if a middle schooler murdered someone? Would it be bad to dunk on them then?" I also got one very interesting reply saying, "It's not just this kid. This kid is a part of a whole group of people that do this regularly and harass artists, writers, and anyone who doesn't fit their ideology with this same mentality. You're saying they're a kid, so it's okay. We'll only encourage anyone who sees your tweet." Which is just, okay. "They're a kid, so it's okay" isn't even what I said. It was that, even ignoring the dubious veracity of this tweet, publicly posting your child dunking and soaking up tens of thousands of replies in praise of you is, at minimum, in poor taste. And also just, this is a censored screenshot. No one has any idea who this hypothetical kid is. And so if you're accusing a random anonymous account of being part of a group of coordinated harassers who target artists with warlike precision, you probably don't have a particularly healthy relationship with the internet, especially if you're then applying this bizarre, uncharitable reading of my tweet as some kind of blanket excusing of children committing war crimes or something. I don't know. Like, if you're doing all that, you should probably just go outside. God, this tweet was a mistake. This tweet was a fucking mistake. Because what was very clear to me in my head of, this is a fucking insane thing to say with no evidence about this unverifiable child and you should go outside, very quickly started to get interpreted as, if anyone is experiencing harassment under any circumstances ever, that person should just go outside because no instance of harassment online matters. Somehow. Like, here's someone responding with, "If your response to being told that multiple people have killed themselves over online harassment is go outside, you are an utterly vile human being." Which, again, "multiple people have killed themselves over online harassment" isn't what the tweet I was responding to said at all. Like, there's an entire conversation that's just happening completely past me here. The whole thing was nuts. Like, people would spam "go outside" at me for months anytime I talked about online harassment of any kind, whether it was toward me or just condemning harassment toward other people. Even now, there's still an entire contingent of people online who seem to just hate follow me and, like, like wait for me to condemn someone being harassed so they can go, well, you told harassment victims to go outside, which no, like goddamn, it was a whole thing. Anyway, I replied to a few other tweets pretty much just saying the same thing I said here, and at one point, I noticed that one of the people responding to me with this barrage of misinterpretation had retweeted this image of a rainbow meat pin with the caption "pro shipper" that included a rainbow flag and pink triangles. I took a screenshot of the pin with the caption, "I don't care about anties or anti-anties or anti-anti-anties or whatever because these are pointless internet terms that can mean almost anything, but can we agree defining your IRL identity by arguments you have with people on Twitter is a sign of being way too online?" Then, a lot of people in meat space are asking me questions about my "I get into enough fights online to label myself in the real world after niche internet argument positions" pins that are already answered by my pin. Then I addressed a typo I made in the original thread. Then I said, "Holy shit, I didn't even notice the pink triangle. Love to use Holocaust imagery for my "I get into online fights and consider this an important enough aspect of my personality to advertise it to people" pin. So for people who don't know, the pink triangle is a symbol traditionally associated with gay rights, but it's also inextricably linked to the mass death of gay men in a variety of different circumstances. So, content warning, I'm going to talk about its history for a second. Skip to this time code if you don't want to hear about that. It was originally used in concentration camps to mark gay and bisexual men, as well as some trans women, as prisoners. Tens of thousands of these people were imprisoned, and many of them were in fact reincarcerated after being liberated, as it remained illegal to be gay after the end of the war. The triangle started being reclaimed by a variety of gay activist groups in the following decades, but it tended to be an explicit reminder of the mass incarceration and lives lost from gay men, rather than exclusively a general pride symbol. Jonathan Ned Katz, a historian born in 1938 who focuses primarily on human sexuality in a historical context, notes that this was often explicitly a response to the homophobic gay fascism conspiracy theory that incorrectly claims that there was an overwhelming proportion of gay men among Nazis. In Katz's words, the adoption of the pink triangle in the 1970s was primarily a response to the vicious, influential myth created by anti-fascists that Nazis were themselves in some basic way homosexual. That is to say, to both remember the way gay men were persecuted and not to allow them to become scapegoats for the rise of fascism. In history professor Eric Jensen's 2002 contribution to the Journal of the History of Sexuality, he notes the names of two West German gay magazines who, in March 1975, published articles encouraging gay men to make themselves visible by wearing the pink triangle, which it promoted as a symbol of ongoing as well as past persecution. It declared at its conclusion, "Show what happened to gays under fascism. Discrimination is still going on. Wear the pink triangle." So it was reclaimed, but always tied to an explicit reminder of the persecution gay men experienced and continue to experience in Germany. The pink triangle gained more prevalence in the 1980s during the AIDS epidemic, which decimated an entire generation of gay men. AIDS organization ACT UP began using the symbol, turning the triangle upside down, as Jensen puts it, to signal their determination to survive. The most famous instance of this is, of course, the "Silence Equals Death" poster that prominently displays the triangle, both as a signifier of historical and ongoing oppression and as a form of resistance against it. In the years surrounding these protests, the triangle also began to be promoted by lesbians, although there existed some debates at the time as to whether queer cisgender women could or should use the triangle as a form of reclamation. There were some attempts among the lesbian community to use a black triangle instead, although it never gained the same prevalence as the pink triangle did. In the years following ACT UP's peak, the triangle remained a popular symbol, and you can find it at a lot of modern pride parades, remaining an indicator of pride, of the memory of gay persecution, and of the community's resolve to survive. So when someone puts the pink triangle on a piece of merchandise to advertise their position on an online posting war about pretend people getting together, I find it pretty tasteless. Not only just the flippant way it's used in general, but the way its use here seems to equate the mass losses of two generations of gay men to pro-shippers versus anties. Even taking the most negative possible interpretation toward anties, I don't think that's an appropriate comparison to make. And secondly, it ties into the way a lot of pro-shippers either implicitly or in many cases explicitly will frame the matter of being a pro-shipper as a gay rights issue. Whether or not you lean more towards being a pro-shipper or an anti, this seems incredibly disingenuous, and it's pretty easy to look online and realize that virtually every single person who has a strong opinion on pro-shippers and antis is a queer person. That's not to say queer people can't themselves act antithetically to their interests, but rather that framing an intra-community posting war between a whole bunch of queer people online as gays versus homophobes, and indeed evoking two incredibly charged comparisons with the use of the pink triangle, is in poor taste at very best. Also, as I said earlier, before even noticing the pink triangle's use, identifying as an online argument term in the real world and like wearing merch about it is just, you know, kind of cringe and also in poor taste. Like, if I went out in public and I was proudly displaying a James Charles opinion haver badge, I just think even without the pink triangle, it's just tacky. But I think the use of the pink triangle is especially noteworthy here because it highlights something that's very potent in this whole shipping war, and that's the common use of extremely emotionally charged language and rhetoric at every corner. Criticizing the judgment of someone's viral thread about their argument with a child online is the same as defending someone literally murdering writers. Liking cartoon Steven Universe is literally supporting fascism. Like, it's wild, y'all. In any case, this series of threads is really what set things off, and it led to some pretty nuts tweets that I'll give you a glimpse of in a second. Another thing that's worth noting, though, is that some of my friends and colleagues online made some vague references to what was happening. Fellow creator Princess Weeks, who made her own absolutely excellent video on this subject, which I'll link in the description, made a thread saying,
"Considering the harassment towards BIPOC folks and the constant misinformation and reaching to make targets of prominent online women, it deeply amuses me when people treat shipping, pro and anti, with so much political importance when they literally apply that to nothing else. And to remove all nuance and context, to share fake quotes and facts, to perpetuate harm in order to own people over the right for two white people to kiss. When you marginalize really queer, BIPOC, and marginalized people, for what?"
And ended up getting some incredibly hostile responses, including a white lady calling her a privileged twat for some fucking reason, I don't know. Fellow creator Lindsay Ellis replied with, "I hate fandom." Like, that was it. That was the entire tweet, just, "I hate fandom," and ended up being bombarded with a bunch of tweets accusing her of some absolutely insane shit. Like, multiple people in the quote tweets accusing her of mocking the death of a child, folks calling her a piece of trash, and some digs about her being a white woman, which is interesting because the exact same people were also harassing Princess. Like, I have screenshots, you look at the usernames, it's the same fucking people. Like, so many assumptions about these people's positions were being made on the basis of, in one case, a thread about how racism gets excused in fan spaces, and in the other case, a three-word tweet. It was nuts. Fellow creator Dan Olson later made this tweet in response to the event, saying, "The internet is a great place. You can buy almost anything you want, you have access to more art than previously created in human history, and if you hurt the feelings of people who really hope two characters from a cartoon for tweens will smooch, they will accuse you of murder." Which, I mean, yeah, accurate. And Dan also got bombarded with tweets accusing him of supporting Gamergate, sending a harassment brigade despite the tweet not addressing any one specific person, saying cyberbullying isn't real, like, multiple times, apparently, trivializing a whole fucking list of bad things here. You get the deal. People also did the same thing to Big Joel, who tweeted in support of me and got the exact same response. "How dare you joke about people who murder children?" Finally, YouTuber Sean made his take, which was literally just, "Haha, I don't understand this," and got some incredible replies equating him to people who were afraid of anti-fascists and saying it was his fault, specifically, that people mocked the existence of death threats. And then there's the way people talked about me, and it's a lot. Let me once again state that if you disagree with my positions here or you think I came off poorly in this entire exchange, I can certainly understand that. I'm not always right about everything, and while I do stand by my positions here, I wouldn't blame anyone for feeling differently about the pro-shipper pin or the ethics of posting a child dunking or whatever. But the responses I got were an absolutely insane barrage of harassment and false information about me, some of which is still being spread around. Even if you think everything I said was completely in the wrong, it certainly doesn't justify what happened next. Here's an abridged list of some of the things I was being accused of solely on the basis of the tweets of mine you saw a few minutes ago. To start, I was accused of saying it's okay to cyberbully people, saying that kids won't harass you if you aren't gross, spearheading a crusade against pro-shippers, being an anti-Raylo fan cop, whatever that is, trying to get a disabled assault survivor to lose their job, supporting people who did that, and also people who want to kill Hannibal showrunner Brian Fuller, being a straight woman, having never struggled with mental illness, gaslighting people, writing a defamatory article on Supernatural comparing Supernatural fans to conspiracy bros, I guess, only participating in fandom so I can mock people, having never been the victim of a harassment campaign, lying about receiving death threats, and these are just the funny ones. I was also accused of, and we're going to get heavy here, making fun of a 16-year-old for being super. Side note, I have no idea who this supposed 16-year-old is or where this came from, like, at all. Supporting the death of a child, mocking the death of a child, pushing people to harm themselves, supporting Holocaust deniers, and perhaps most egregiously, belonging to a sex cult that assaults and murders children. No, I am not joking, this was an actual accusation that got spread about me by a real person. Like, I'm intentionally playing up how ridiculous and absurd this all was, but I would like everyone to just stop and consider what it might feel like to have someone make that accusation about you on a public platform. Not only that, but on top of being subject to a ton of verbal abuse, being called a horrible and disgusting person and the like, I also experienced stuff like, at one point I posted that I was going on a walk and took a picture of the trail, and someone responded telling me they now knew where I lived. A popular tweet from a pro-shipper account suggested that if I were to make a video about this subject, they should all mass report it and get it taken down. Those were the same pro-shippers who talked about how antis are bad because they're always trying to get people fired and harm their jobs during a panini. That tweet also said that I gave real female geeks and gamers a bad name, which is just very interesting, just a group of people vowing to try and sabotage a woman's career while justifying it by saying she's a fake gamer. It's cool, doesn't remind me of anything. There was a whole bunch of shit like that. This was at its height, thousands upon thousands of people making, liking, and sharing these tweets, many of whom, as far as I can tell, still spread a lot of this stuff around to this day. People were making podcast episodes about me. I had a colleague say he didn't want to work with me at that point because he was scared of the backlash around being associated with me. Like, it was a lot. I'm going to put the original things I said back up on the screen so you can compare the scale of what was actually said to the absolutely unhinged scale of horrific actions and opinions that were assigned to me over the course of that week. The common thread with all of this is that you had folks generating a massive list of supposed positions from a single tweet, and their replies thus weren't actually responses to me or my friend's tweets, they were responses to this imagined list of positions these people had ascribed to my friends. That's how you get, "I think child death is hilarious," from "I hate fandom." This is a phenomenon that's not unique to this specific controversy, but is pretty common across social media and especially platforms like Twitter. We treat the individuals we argue with not as complex and unique in their views, but as proxies for sets of beliefs we ascribe to them, usually based on one or two things we know about them. We just interact with too many people every day now to parse their beliefs as unique holes, and websites sites like Twitter are perfectly designed to engender this kind of arguing and harassment. This is a phenomenon that journalist Zeeshan Aleem described as disinterpretation in a really excellent thread. It's a long thread to read in its entirety, so I've shortened it a bit to read out loud, but I will link to it in the description. Aleem writes,
"Every post is seen as a proxy for some broader orientation which must be sorted into the bin of good/bad. The text itself is often largely irrelevant. Remarkably, this filtration process is so intense that people want to sort out any given comment into one of these bins before they've even fully interpreted them. There's an almost algorithmic quality to the way that this scanning and sorting process works, which would explain how people come to conclusions that often don't make much sense outside of the function of identifying irregularities in the discourse."
And in my opinion, that's exactly what's happening here. A few tweets condemning the ridiculousness of the entire situation are immediately sorted into the bin of, well, that's an anti-opinion to have, and are therefore equated with the worst of the anti-category. If you say you think a pro-shipper pin is in poor taste, or you think accusing someone of murder for saying that is absurd, you are on the side of the murderers and are thus essentially supporting murder. And of course, some of this also factors into our tendency to overstate harm. Just saying something is kind of mean, or kind of tacky, or kind of shitty doesn't necessarily generate the same buzz or mass condemnation that you might want, which can incentivize people to go for the most dramatic language possible when talking about someone's actions in order to guarantee that they'll be heard. In some ways, it's actually very similar to mass outrage against specific pieces of media. Saying you don't like a ship or a TV show, or that you think it's in poor taste, is just a lot less provocative than saying that, I don't know, that kind of dorky gay dating simulator where everyone is a dad is homophobic for having a scrapped cult ending hidden in the files. In any case, these tweets eventually grew in so much scale and prominence that it caught the eye of Brian fucking Fuller, like the Brian Fuller who made Hannibal and Pushing Daisies and American Gods, that Brian Fuller. Someone made this tweet, tagging me, might I add, basically saying I was doing terrible villainy and can Daddy Brian Fuller please give them a golden star. And Brian Fuller was like, fuck yeah, go pro shippers, and like tried to order the pink triangle pro shipper pin, but it was out of stock because me talking about the pin meant that all the pro shippers, as you might expect, went and bought the pin. You're welcome, pin makers. So Brian Fuller bought some pro shipper socks and a mug and a t-shirt instead, all with the same design, and posted a picture of his merch on Twitter, which is just incredible to me. I don't know. I saw a tacky, probably fake viral tweet, and because of the domino effect, Brian Fuller owns a pair of rainbow meat pink triangle pro shipper socks. I just want to highlight the absurdity of that for a moment. All the while, these people were critiquing me for being like irresponsible with my platform for responding to accounts smaller than mine, and then they tag me in their tweets going like, isn't she the worst? Am I right? Two-time Emmy Award-nominated showrunner with hundreds of thousands of Twitter followers, Brian Fuller. I did actually reach out to Brian Fuller via email after writing this script in hopes of getting some kind of comment, but I haven't heard back yet. Luckily, this was really the peak of it, and it did die down after this, but as I said, it created an entire contingent of people out there who are utterly convinced that I, like, mocked child death or said online harassment campaigns didn't exist in any context ever, and these people will hate follow me, and now every time I talk about how online harassment is bad and we should support harassment victims, they're like, but I thought you were an anti, checkmate. Or like one time I was like, hey, it's okay for people to have kinks and you're not helping people by stigmatizing that. And they were like, I can't believe you said that while also being an anti. I think this is just a really interesting case study of the entire event because the actual statements made, by and large, didn't reference a lot of things people later came to claim they did. But by virtue of these statements existing in the broader context of the shipping war, they are, as that aforementioned thread on disinterpretation put it, seen as a proxy for a broader orientation and are instantly sorted into that bin. Suffice it to say, the way this fan wank has tried to push push every possible issue surrounding fiction and how we consume it and how we respond to other people's needs in fan spaces into two diametrically opposed camps that must, under all circumstances, stay united on the party line is a pretty clear example of why the labels of anti and pro-shipper are useless at best and actively deeply harmful at worst. Fuck, that was a long sentence. Why do I write these? Why don't you stop me? I'm like, ooh, hoot-doo-doo, this is going to be such a good script. I'm not thinking of my future self who has to actually say the fucking words. The main issue here really is that these labels flatten out any nuance in favor of two absolutist claims about the entirety of the world. I talked at the beginning of the video about how supports problematic ships and opposes problematic ships carry a lot of vagueness. What does it mean to support something? What even constitutes a problematic ship? They're vague enough that I personally have been accused of being both an anti and a pro shipper solely on the basis of the fictional pretend characters I ship. During the whole fuckinging, I made a tweet saying I liked the idea of these Avatar characters getting together, and I had people being like, how could you? I thought you were an anti. How could you betray us like this? The idea, then, is that an anti must therefore oppose every single ship any person could ever theoretically deem as problematic. Conversely, a pro-shipper must therefore support, on some level, every single one of those ships, or at least every single one of those ships' right to exist and be published for public consumption online. And like I said before, although shipper is theoretically the main locus for this debate, it isn't actually just about shipping, but about all kinds of supposedly problematic media. See, what this ends up doing is essentially conflating a wide number of things with completely different intentions and completely different impacts on the world. For example, a phrase that ends up getting thrown around in pro-shipper and anti-shipper circles is the idea that depiction is not inherently the same thing as endorsement. So just because a piece of media depicts, for example, a toxic relationship or bad things happening to certain characters, that does not necessarily mean that a piece of media endorses those things. This is, of course, a completely true statement on its own, but in these circles, it ends up getting thrown around as mostly a sick dunk rather than an actual conversation about what the difference might look like. On one end, you'll have people, many of whom consider themselves antis, who will critique specific pieces of media seemingly just because they depict awful things in them. For example, a few years back on Tumblr, it became particularly common to disavow the Korean webcomic Killing Stalking, which focuses on the abusive relationship between a serial killer and his stalker, whom he has kidnapped, just by literally listing all the bad things in it. It has a mentally ill person who is a stalker, all of these bad and awful things happen to him, etc. It was rarely like, here's how these events are framed in the story, but rather just the mere fact that bad things happened to a character. And that's not to say no one was criticizing it through the lens of what the story was trying to say, or analyzing whether the story portrayed the relationship as good. Certainly that existed, and I don't want to say those people don't have a point either, but you also had an entire culture of like call out posts for this comic saying, don't read this, it has bad things and therefore it is problematic. God, I'm trying to imagine what those threads would look like if they existed for like any other piece of horror media, like don't watch the Saw movies, there are suicidal characters who die in them and that's bad, that's not a thing we should support. Or similarly, you see these Twitter threads often from teenagers that get circulated around every so often about how classical literature is terrible and bad because The Great Gatsby is trying to teach us that rich people are good and Huckleberry Finn is trying to teach us that racism is good and so on and so forth. And again, there are discussions to be had as to whether these books appropriately convey their themes, but that's often not what's happening here. It's just, well, this story has the bad thing in it and you should therefore not support it. And so certainly you have a culture of people here who read the depiction of terrible acts as endorsements of those acts in a fictional context on the part of the author, or worse, endorsements of those acts in real life. Conversely though, you also have people on the pro-shipper end essentially taking depiction is not endorsement to mean that depiction is in all cases inherently neutral. That is to say that we can never make critiques of what we believe a piece of media is trying to say, lest we be considered pro-censorship puritans incapable of distinguishing between between fiction and real life, because certainly mature audiences should be able to parse out themes on their own. If we watch a movie where a character is bigoted, for instance, we should be able to determine for ourselves that bigotry is wrong. Mature audiences certainly aren't looking to works of fiction as moral guides, and so simplistic ways of engaging with fictional narratives that merely look at, is a bad thing present in this story, or is the character sufficiently punished for their wrongdoing, is, well, childish. And a lot of posts made by pro-shippers do reflect that audiences don't need narratives to explicitly tell them a thing is bad, Goofus and Gallant style, lest they be mistaken for endorsing murder or whatever. At the same time, however, narratives generally have perspectives, they have themes. That's not to say every piece of work is a fable with a moral, but choices like whose perspective we show, what we choose to spend time on, what characters do we get to see as people with rich inner lives, these say things about the story's themes. Really simple example here, but Pretty Little Liars and Boy Meets World are both shows that used to air, that are aimed toward teens. Both have scenes or arcs that focus on a teacher-student relationship in some capacity, but both stories frame these things very differently, one having several seasons focus heavily on the romantic aspects of their relationship, and one having an episode lean really, really heavily into the discomfort associated with professors hitting on their students. It's not necessarily that you need to have a moral, but it's disingenuous to insinuate that anyone who notices or critiques framing is just incapable of knowing for themselves that these things are bad or that they're seeking out fiction as a moral guide. To use a really extreme example, and content warning, I'm about to talk about racism here, The Turner Diaries, a 1978 novel that depicts a society where white people seek to systematically exterminate non-white people, had a massive influence among far-right extremists and helped popularize a number of far-right ideals and real-life hate crimes. The fact that the story depicts these things happening doesn't mean that the story is endorsing them. But also, yes, the story is still endorsing them. People who critique the book aren't saying that they themselves are incapable of distinguishing between fiction and reality. Rather, they're critiquing what they perceive to be the story's message. And what seems to be the common pro-shipper line in response to any moral critique of fiction, that is, anyone who says this simply wants fiction to be their moral guide, doesn't necessarily hold up when that isn't always the argument antis are making. If you want an example of what this argument looks like in practice, think back to one of those first tweets that I showed you at the beginning of the video where someone was like, hey, I think it sucks when you have stories where people date the children they raised as soon as those children turned 18, and someone was like, so you can't tell the difference between fiction and reality, huh? This has even created problems in pro-shipper communities before, where overt racism in art is ignored or excused because, well, censorship is wrong and criticizing things is clearly the same as censorship, and if you point out that a piece of work is racist, you clearly can't tell the difference between fiction and reality. Princess Weeks talked a lot about this in her own video on shipping. Once again, it's a really excellent video. A lot of it was about her own feelings as a black woman in fandom, where she's had self-identified aunties harass her for things like shipping Zuko Avatar and Katara Avatar together and imply her liking two fictional animated friends from a 2005 children's show getting together means she supports colonization, but at the same time has had pro-shippers harass her when she talks about racism in fandom and how it's often excused or swept under the rug in favor of shipping wars. One of the things she talked about, though, was the Confederate flag bikini incident. I know, that fucking intro to that, right? Where an artist drew a character wearing a bikini with a Confederate flag on it. Some people of color, many of whom identified as pro-shippers, were like, hey, this is pretty racist, and those people were essentially forced out of the pro-shipper community for supposedly being pro-censorship. And so certainly there is a problem among pro-shipper communities of assuming any moral critique of a piece of art is inherently censorship, and this problem can seek to marginalize the most vulnerable members of fandom communities. Fandom has, by and large, always had problems with racism, and you can see how a blanket implication that depiction and endorsement in no contexts are ever linked and that anyone who says otherwise just thinks fiction is the same thing as reality can be dangerous. And just to be clear, regarding my earlier book example, I am not trying to claim here that there exist pro-shippers who are directly defending the Turner Diaries or trying to claim people's weird incest fanfiction or whatever is on par with the Turner Diaries. I'm not trying to seek to compare those those things. What I'm trying to say here is that it is simultaneously true that depiction of horrific things in fiction is not endorsement, and that people should be allowed to make messy art engaging with those things, and also that endorsement of horrific things in fiction still exists, and that the mere act of making those critiques is not a tacit statement that you yourself cannot tell the difference between fiction and reality. Indeed, many of the underlying beliefs I discussed at the beginning of the video are not actually at odds with one another. Fiction is not reality, and fiction has some impact on reality are not actually contradictory statements, but they do seemingly belong to contradictory quote-unquote sides of the shipping war. Similarly, depiction is not endorsement, and endorsement is still a thing in some fictional works, though, are not actually contradictory either. What this flattening of nuance does is create a system where you must support or oppose all things considered problematic, which can essentially do the job of implying that all problematic fiction is on the same level. In a way, it kind of reminds me of the way discussions around supporting free speech get framed. The idea is, well, you know, you support freedom of speech in all instances or you oppose it. On first examination, people will often say there should be no restrictions on speech at all, no laws restricting what people say or consequences for any kind of speech. But in the context of things like, say, prank calling 911 or shouting fire in a crowded theater or calling in a threat or publishing libel, that conversation starts to look a little different. When we acknowledge this is the case, we can similarly acknowledge that it's not an all or nothing situation with a red team and a blue team and stop talking about it as such. Rather, it's not a matter of do we tolerate this always or never, but rather what do we tolerate and in what contexts? When we don't tolerate something, what should the scale of our opposition look like? Because certainly, fiction is not literally reality, and certainly, fiction has the ability to impact the real world in at least some sense. And this, I think, is the main shortcoming of the labels of pro-shipper and anti. They make it so that these conversations can't exist at all. Rather, they're only ever framed in the context of puritanical moral panics or blanket refusal to engage with good faith critiques of fictional works. What I'm essentially trying to say here, in not so many words, is that this entire thing would be a lot better off if people just abandoned the terms pro-shipper and anti for good and just said exactly specifically what they meant regarding individual pieces of fiction and how we should engage with them. But of course, this isn't the world we live in. We live in a world where these two camps of self-described antis and pro-shippers exist, in a world where they organize in their own forums and Twitter groups and Discord servers, in a world where cancellations and shipping wars are a part of daily life. So, moving beyond Twitter controversies about me or a Confederate flag bikini, what does this look like? Well, as I said earlier, hashtag both sides pretty much make the same claim here. That is, that they just want to exist in fandom spaces, but that the way the other group acts makes those fandom spaces unsafe for them. This comment on Princess's video where someone says, "I wouldn't be in the please stop sending me death threats club if people didn't keep sending me death threats," exemplifies that mentality pretty clearly. So, is there truth to that? Yes and no. Yes, in the sense that harassment based on the work people create or their positions on shipping-related arguments absolutely exists. I will also say, while I've used the word harassment a few times already in this video, I've personally come to dislike it as a catch-all term for kind of the same reason I dislike pro and anti. It encompasses so many behaviors and so many actions and boils it down to an almost detached, sanitized label. Just saying harassment is an offhanded thing, like sure, whatever, harassment. Saying the specifics of what it actually means, people threatening to come to where you live and hurt you when you have no idea how credible that is, people doing their darndest to make everyone they come across believe you've done horrible things, or even just the more mundane feeling of having dozens to thousands of people spam you with verbal abuse about how awful you are is a lot more visceral, and if we're gonna have conversations about harassment, makes the reality of it a lot harder to brush off. In any case, this has absolutely happened to people as a result of the shipping war. So first things first, what we would consider to be moral panics within fandom spaces based on the supposedly problematic nature of fandom-centric media, be it fanfiction or just media that has a big fandom around it, absolutely do exist. And yes, I would also go so far as to say that there does exist a culture of puritanism as well. This is complicated by the fact that I also think there's a culture of just falsely labeling people as Puritans because you don't like what they have to say. Makes it really frustrating that those are both simultaneously true. So what does this look like? Well, for starters, a popular concept among some fandom circles, typically among people who consider themselves anties, is this concept of irredeemable media. Generally, this is paired with a DNI, which if you don't know, is basically a list some people will put on their social media profiles that stands for Do Not Interact. So some adults will have like Do Not Interact if you're a minor, some minors will have like Do Not Interact if you're an adult, etc., etc. Generally, you see something like Do Not Interact if you support irredeemable media, and then you get this long list of what these people deem to be irredeemable. That is to say, anyone who likes or consumes this is a bad person and must be shunned. And the funniest thing about this to me is that it's always just the dumbest bullshit that gets put on the list of what they consider to be the worst pieces of media in the world. It's very unintentionally revealing. You'll often see stuff like Attack on Titan, which, fair enough, lots of Japanese nationalism in there, I get it. But then you keep reading through and it's like Homestuck and Steven Universe, which is a colorful cartoon for children, and then like Has-Been Hotel or the YouTube video of Thomas Sanders, a YouTuber who makes theater videos primarily for children. Like, a theme starts to arise, which is that all the examples people can come up with of the most horrible, irredeemable, awful stuff out there is like mostly kids' media or some niche webcomic or web series. Also, as I've talked about extensively, especially with stuff like Steven Universe, it tends to be stuff associated with diverse casts and creators. Lots of reasons for that. I have a whole video about it elsewhere. It both betrays a childishness and lack of worldliness that the most egregious media in existence to these people are cartoons for babies, and also just demonstrates a very odd absolutism as well. Like, Steven Universe is irredeemable? Really? That's your baseline for something that not only has problems, but is so deeply morally repugnant that it can never be redeemed? Don't fucking talk to me if you watch the worst human scum on the planet, if you allow yourself to consume the kinds of virulent horrors you will find should your sadistic mind find its way over to the disgusting piece of media whose name we whisper, to the show we call Fairy Princess Sparkle Tina's Magic Horse Adventure. I think this is worsened by the fact that our society is so heavily focused on consumption that we often can't conceive of either activism that is separate from consumption or consumption that is separate from activism. What shows we choose to stream are not only seen as expressions of our innate moral virtues, but often they are even seen as the deepest and most revealing expressions of those moral virtues. And I do get it, especially now of all times, because it's hard for people to organize in person right now, and it's especially hard for young people to do that in general. So policing whether someone watches Voltron or whatever is a really easy and accessible way to feel like you're doing the world some good. But ultimately, it's not doing the good that people hope it is. And oftentimes, this culture of we must throw out anything we might possibly have a problem with and deem irredeemable combines with this culture of overstating harm in a really interesting way. So to lead into this, I think there's definitely been a bit of a culture shift over the last decade in the direction of people moralizing their likes and dislikes. Your interests are meant not just to be things that make you happy, but rather deep expressions of your moral virtue. This often leads to people feeling the need to justify the things they like as the purest things out there, which of course comes in a lot of flavors. Oftentimes, there will be takes on the internet about how dressing in a certain way is some kind of revolutionary praxis, or how it's super feminist to wear pinup makeup or whatever. You can't just like a thing, that thing has to be a deep moral good. Oftentimes, this can lead to a lot of defensiveness when someone dislikes a thing you like, because they then aren't just attacking your interest, they're attacking your morality. But besides needing to morally justify liking a thing, there's also a culture where people seemingly need to morally justify disliking a thing. I remember so many times on the internet where I've posted about not liking a certain singer or actor and immediately having my mentions flooded with people asking, like, what did they do? Did they do something awful? The idea that if you dislike something, you need a moral justification for it can be pretty dangerous. And when you don't have that moral justification, it can often lead to having to manufacture one. In my opinion, overstating harm is a huge issue in progressive spaces right now. And some of that is probably partly due to how social media, especially Twitter, is set up. There's this desire for people to equate, I don't like this cartoon, or parts of this show for babies made me uncomfortable, to, this is irredeemably awful. But you're not gonna get a lot of reach or engagement with these claims just by saying, some elements of this were mishandled, or I have complex feelings about the way they resolved this character's arc. Which is how you get people making really exaggerated claims about specific pieces of media, like, how dare you like She-Ra, where two characters who grew up together as wards of an evil cartoon dictator get together? That's literally the exact same as being sisters, and so the show literally supports siblings dating each other. That's a really fucking popular take about that show for some reason. I have nothing. I remember once I was remarking on my Tumblr about how after Avatar got put on Netflix, it led to an influx of ship wars and toxicity that had previously mellowed out, and someone replied with a great sentence. They said, the kinds of drama and discourse are the same as they were in 2009, but now if you ship the wrong ship, you're either a pedophile or a colonizer, which, yeah, that about sums it up. Or what happened to the creator of Lore Olympus, a long-form webcomic retelling the Hades and Persephone story, who's repeatedly had the label of pedophile thrown at her for writing a romance between a 19-year-old and an ancient god. Which, you know, if that age gap makes people uncomfortable, that's fine, and I get it. I personally don't love that either, that's part of why I don't read the comic, but the problem here is the same as the problem in the previous examples. The most dramatic labels for that possible situation often get carelessly thrown around, often by people who are, based on their list of what they consider irredeemable media, very young, and it makes fan spaces less safe and a lot more hostile. Oftentimes, people are discouraged from even watching shows deemed problematic to see for themselves what the problem is. To do so after they literally heard from secondhand information about how awful it is seen as suspicious. After all, interacting with irredeemable media is often enough to get you on a DNI. As a result, this information often comes from getting passed around like four levels of Twitter telephone, with the most serious accusations the people can think of getting the most traction. And often this can lead to online abuse being directed toward the creators of irredeemable media and to their fans. This especially becomes pernicious when it comes to the creators of fan works in those communities. People who draw fan art or write fan fiction of stories and ships arbitrarily deemed to be irredeemable as a result of some mishandled themes or the personal discomfort it caused someone, or in some extreme examples, literally just made up reasons that get passed around via telephone. I can't pull out a list of citations here, but if you're willing to take my word for it, I can absolutely say that I know people in these spaces who have stopped producing work because of this kind of harassment. And it especially pushes the most marginalized people to the back of the stage, often forcing them out of those spaces. Princess Weeks's video made the very good point that being accused of being pro-colonizer for what you ship is going to hit a lot harder if you're a person of color in those spaces, or even just from the perspective of being a writer. If you're a queer storyteller telling a queer story in a medium that's historically been hostile to that, it's going to hit a lot harder that you're being accused of supporting incest for having two characters who grew up together date. Those are horrible things to baselessly accuse anyone of, but especially over the overstated harm supposedly done by a fanfiction or a cartoon. I also just think it's interesting how much of an overemphasis these people put on fandom in a you need to log off way. There are oftentimes these callouts for fanfictions with subject matter no worse than you could find in any public library, or even just anger at AO3 for hosting such fanfictions when, again, you could find similar works in any bookstore or library, which is just interesting to me. The fact that people are willing to focus so much on fandom as the space with far greater capacity to do evil than anything else just makes me think some of these people need to broaden their perspective. I don't mean this derisively toward people who are in fandom, I am also in fandom, But fandom is not as important as you think it is. And so believe me when I say that I have no trouble at all believing that some of the problems self-described pro-shippers identify in fandom spaces do exist. A problem of puritanism, a problem of wild callouts and verbal abuse directed toward creators and fans, a problem of moralizing your own likes and dislikes to an insane degree, and a problem of vastly overstating harm. I have seen firsthand that this culture exists and that it is capable of pushing people out of fandom spaces for crimes no greater than thinks two cartoon characters are cute together, or likes to read horror webcomics sometimes, or posts about Steven Universe. I think to that end, there is a problem of this nature that absolutely exists in fan spaces, and it's something worth talking about. That being said, I think there's a major gap in the pro-shipper narrative here, and that's the assumption that these kinds of moral outrage brigades, the harassment people talk about, the overstatement of harm, are exclusively endemic to people who self-identify as anties. That is absolutely not true, and in fact, a large volume of this kind of vitriol and overstated harm comes from people who are, in their own words, doing so in the name of freedom of expression. The first example I can think of is obvious. People accusing me of an absolutely insane collection of horrific actions for a couple of tweets that should have at best been something to say I disagree with this to. People telling me they knew what neighborhood I lived in or calling me a genocide denier in the name of anti-bullying. That whole thing to me makes it fairly obvious that a large volume of these people don't actually universally oppose harassment, they oppose people harassing them. But again, this isn't all a video about me, no, because this is a problem that extends far beyond any one individual. The aforementioned Confederate flag incident is a similar example of this, and an example specifically of how deriding anyone who makes any kind of critique of fictional works as a fan cop anti who doesn't know what fiction is can make fandom spaces actively hostile to specific groups, especially people of color. A whole bunch of pro-shippers chose to die on the hill that criticizing a racy, furry bikini fan art that had a Confederate flag in it was the same as censorship and made people anties. A lot of these replies have since been deleted because the whole thing transpired last October, but you can still see some posts that have been archived with things like, well, as pro-shippers, we don't get to pick and choose what we defend at the forefront of the case here. It led a few black pro-shippers to break off from the community, coining the label Faya instead. This label was originally mostly created as a joke, but later started to be used seriously, with the essential meaning being that they supported people's right to express themselves freely and make whatever content they wanted, with the exception of things that were racist or that brought non-consenting people into the equation. So things like not safe for work stories about real human beings who were minors, which yes, is a thing that exists and is a thing that many pro-shippers categorically defend. This, of course, led to the pro-shipper community calling people who used the label anti-light and, well, you get the idea. The whole thing is a mess. The label isn't really used much anymore for some other reasons, but it's a good indicator of the if you're not with us, you're against us mentality that's cropped up in these spaces. We have to defend any and all work from any and all criticism, and anyone who refuses to do so is an anti and therefore allied with literal murderers. It's also just pretty easy to find pro-shippers in pro-shipper spaces seemingly seeking out content to get mad at or engaging with people they don't have to, despite their entire ethos ostensibly being if you see content you don't like, just block and move on. If you go looking, you'll see almost daily some viral thread where a teenager goes, "Shipping this thing is bad," and a bunch of pro-shippers, many of whom have minors do not interact in their Twitter bios, will quote tweet the person and engage with the tweet in order to argue with it and like accuse the original poster of supporting harassment. Even when no actual harassment took place in that exchange. And the only people currently seeking out someone else's content to argue with them are the supposed pro-shippers. Much like with the other examples, the line of reasoning seems to be essentially that anyone who says this thing or that thing must be sorted into the category of anti, and the category of anti includes harassers and child murderers, so if you say anything that vaguely reminds me of something an anti would say, you are an evil human being and anything done to you is fair game. If you didn't want the consequences of being an anti, you shouldn't have been an anti. Pro-shipper means anti-harassment. Okay, I've been putting this off for a while now, but I feel like this is probably an important time to elaborate on a theme you've likely seen pop up throughout the course of this video. And that's the fact that time and time again, you'll see that line of children are literally dead or people have been literally harassed on the streets for being pro-shippers. And so I think it's worth looking at what I said about self-described antis and overstated harm and see how it applies here. Another warning, I am about to talk about suicide. If you don't want to hear about that, skip to this time code. So if you spend enough time following pro-shipper circles, one piece of information you'll hear about a lot is like, children have died over this, people have been sent to the hospital over this, people have been physically attacked over this, etc. So is that true? After I myself started to get a bunch of replies saying some buck wild shit like, a child is dead and you laughed it off, I did look into it and the results are extremely, extremely tenuous. The first incident people will bring up a lot is something called the needle cookie incident. Izzy's has a video on it, so I would ideally like to refer you to that and I will put that link in the description, but the basic narrative is, according to pro-shippers, there was a convention in Taiwan where a fan artist who drew Sans X Frisk, the child Frisk fan art, was given a cookie by an auntie that had a needle in it, with the auntie trying to hurt them because of the ship and they needed to go to the hospital. Izzy looked deeper into it and found out that while, yes, there is photographic evidence to suggest that this artist was given a needle cookie, the whole an auntie did this narrative was not a thing. Nowhere in this artist's original post did they mention ships or aunties, and nowhere in any of the original replies did it come up either. The narrative that this was specifically something done because of this person fan art or because of aunties was something that was invented later by the English-speaking pro-shipper community, and there is broadly no particular reason to believe that aunties were at work here. The people actually involved have never given any indication that this is what happened. There are a few other similar incidents where pro-shippers will point to instances where some kind of harassment did exist but had nothing to do with self-described aunties. There's the commonly cited incident of a Steven Universe fan artist who got a lot of online abuse, and while I don't want to go too into that one because a lot of people get that one wrong and I think the artist just wants to be left alone, it was an awful thing, but it wasn't related to aunties and pro-shippers. The second oft-cited incident involves the Instagram account of a teenager who published a shock story about some Minecraft streamers and then made an Instagram post apologizing with a vague reference at the end that they were going to attempt to take their own life. That's the only thing on their entire Instagram, there's no web archive of it, so I can't even confirm that they really are the person who wrote the story, and there's really no way to verify that the person is no longer alive. As someone who was also a teenager in fandom on the internet and had many friends who were teenagers in fandom on the internet, posting something like this and then just logging off, even when you're fine, was a thing people did a lot. And I'm not saying this to be a callous asshole. I'm saying this because these kinds of Twitter rumors about people dying as a result of fandom have been a thing for a while, and oftentimes they end up getting circulated and widely accepted as unambiguous fact, even when there's evidence to the contrary. Indeed, another example of an almost identical phenomenon happened back in 2013. The documentary Crazy About One Direction framed people who shipped One Direction members Louis and Harry in a negative light, and backlash among One Direction fans to the doc somehow engendered the claim that the documentary had led to the deaths of 42 fans. After the documentary came out, the hashtag #RIPLarryShippers trended, with lots of members of that shipping fandom talking about how persecuted these shippers were and saying things like, we lost a lot of shippers last night and I really feel for their families, and essentially making the exact same claims that pro-shippers are making now. That their critics and people who frame them in a negative light are, if not directly responsible for these deaths, at the very least complicit in them. Some tweets were also saying it was 14 of them and not 42. The Daily Dot later did an investigation of these 42 accounts and were only able to find 3 accounts with any indication of being tied to this at all. And in all of these cases, there was no way to confirm that they had died, they just hadn't posted in the last 12 hours. One later came back onto Twitter to confirm she was fine. Another's account is now deleted, but it's pretty easy to find a record that that account was posting and replying to people at least a month after this all apparently happened. And the last one, there's very, very little record of at all, except for like third-hand mentions. But as far as I can glean, what seems to have happened is that her sister later tweeted to confirm that she was fine and was replying to people with what folks at the time described as the same typing style. Long story short, no one died. And I don't doubt that people experienced a lot of online hatred as a result of what they shipped, but the whole bodies in the street angle based on nothing but a few concerning tweets and inactivity turned out to be a massive overstatement of that harm. And that's a real problem and remains to be so in these pro-shipper circles. The fact that hundreds to thousands of people have jumped on these cases, some of which are real cases of online vitriol but have nothing to do with shipping arguments, and some of which are at most unconfirmed rumors, in order to accuse anyone who makes even the slightest critiques of pro-shippers or just refuses to be labeled in this dumb culture war or suggests the whole thing is petty and pointless of being allied with those who would support the deaths of children, is actually a really fucked up thing. Many people in this community see anyone who opposes them as fundamentally evil as a result of this, and therefore it is fair game to do and say anything you want to these horrible monsters. Keep in mind that this is a community of people who, according to them, have formed because of this very problem, and yet this is also a group of people who are willing to accept completely uncritically that their opponents have a body count, that they're going around sticking needles in people's cookies and whatnot, and are willing to accuse anyone who opposes them in any way of essentially being okay with this. If a human being came up to you in any other interaction and accused you of just loving mass death, you would probably be, rightfully, extremely, extremely insulted. But because of the nature of how absolutely off the rails this thing has gotten, where it's normalized that someone might say that to you just because you say, like, hey, I don't think it's cool to write not safe for work stories about real human minors, or I think this has just all gotten out of hand or whatever, it's seen as an absolutely regular, par for the course thing to be accused of. And that's wild, right? I've been talking about large-scale incidents up until now, but I also do just want to mention small instances of online harassment that aren't notable in and of themselves to have ever made news, but that happen on the daily, which is that specific individuals who engage in this kind of discourse will often tell you straight up, I've experienced this kind of online harm in really awful ways. And I do just want to straight up say, yes, this is true. Even in the absence of huge stories like needle cookies or YouTube essays or anything like that, this entire thing leads to regular run-of-the-mill social media users on all ends of the spectrum that people pretend isn't a spectrum to experience really awful shit. I just want to acknowledge that, and that we don't need to overstate harm on any side here to acknowledge that this is a real problem. There don't need to have been deaths for online abuse in fandom spaces to be an issue. And I do just want to say, in case this hasn't been an obvious undercurrent throughout the video, that I absolutely do not support anyone being sent threats or online abuse, and that by and large, if someone tells me that they've experienced those things, I believe them. There is a real problem of this happening, and as much as people do not want you to acknowledge this, neither side has a monopoly on being subject to it or on being opposed to it. So suffice it to say, as these communities exist right now, they're a mess. Again, all of these labels serve to conflate a million different things that exist in fiction and a million different things that exist in real life and a million different positions on fiction, and the way they're framed as categorical and absolute cuts out any possibility for nuance. The fact that a group of people emerged from pro-shipper communities and said, we're pro-shippers but racism isn't okay and sexualizing real life children isn't okay and we're immediately accused of being Anti's light is a good piece of evidence for this. So why is this such a problem in the first place? I've mentioned a few reasons now. I do want to caution against the universal claim that this is a recent phenomenon. Some of the most insane drama or wank in fandoms came out of the 1990s, and things like ship wars were absolutely nuts even then. You can see a lot of that even in things like the Ms. Scribe story. And things like people's not safe for work fanfiction being purged from the internet was, I would say, far, far worse in ye olden days than it is now. But I would also note that in previous times, if you saw a ship you didn't like, it was more likely that that was because you would have to seek it out. If you were a Harry and Ginny shipper, you would have to make a lot more of an effort to find Harry and Hermione fanfiction that you hated because things existed in their own specialized sites and forums. Whereas it's a lot easier nowadays in Thunderdome platforms like Twitter to be exposed to things you hate. And when you hate something and you have to see it all the time, it plays into this issue of, like I said earlier, this need to morally justify one's interests. The only way to stop seeing Harry x Hermione in a world where it's almost impossible to block and curate, because even when you try, things are always getting recommended to you, is to convince everyone you can that it is not just not for you, but wrong. And again, this two camps thing makes me feel the need to state that I am not talking about things like racism or inappropriate treatment of minors here. But I think the way social media websites are set up now means that people are more likely to be exposed to fan stuff they strongly dislike than before. And this "we must moralize all our likes and dislikes" trend can make this go south quickly. As this video was being edited, another controversy among the progressive gaming community broke out on Twitter. The recently released game Boyfriend Dungeon, a Kickstarter-funded dating simulator that includes elements of dungeon crawling and urban fantasy, turned out to feature a route where one of the dateable characters turns out to be a stalker, aggressively pursuing the main character via texts and making a lot of inappropriate and unwanted advances. And this is causing a bit of a stir because it's an important part of the story the game developers wanted to tell. There's a content warning for the stalking before you play the game, although it is pretty vague about how deeply the game explores themes of stalking. And some people were unhappy with this because they didn't feel like the content warning was thorough enough or adequately informed players of what was going to happen. So on August 14th, the developers made a tweet saying they were going to update the content warning to be a bit more clear. And audiences were still angry. There were a ton of tweets saying they should not only warn for the stalker subplot, but should in fact remove it entirely, or at the very least, give players the chance to opt out of it. A lot of popular tweets on the matter, including a thread with hundreds of likes, describes this subplot's inclusion in the game as essentially a consent violation. There are also a lot of people talking about it as an accessibility issue. The idea is that, by virtue of the game including elements of stalking at all, even with a warning, not everyone would be able to play because some people might have trauma surrounding it, and it's therefore unethical for the game in its current state to even exist. The natural implication, then, is that anything short of restricting the kinds of stories that can be told is not only insufficient, but actively hostile to people with trauma. To counter this, we might be tempted to point out that some creators tell and share these kinds of narratives to cope with their own trauma, and art can be a vital tool for exploring trauma, and it's equally restrictive to discourage them from telling their own stories, but honestly, we don't have to. An author's personal experiences here are none of our business. It doesn't matter because fundamentally, this way of viewing art that sees upsetting content as an accessibility issue is untenable. The breadth of things that might trigger or upset a person is essentially infinite. The human experience is diverse, and a piece of media that everyone on Earth will find appropriate to consume doesn't exist. The strange thing is that the debate isn't over whether or not the portrayal of the stalker character is problematic or written poorly or offensive or tasteless or anything like that, but just the existence of such a plotline at all. Like, the general consensus from people who've played it is that the topic is explored well and the creators had a clear intention and goal with regards to exploring potential toxic relationship options and how that relates to dating sims. And keep in mind, for better or for worse, from my understanding, it is an important part of the plot. Like, it's a prominent factor in the story. Some people have compared it to another option in the game where you can opt out of messages from your in-game parent in case you, in real life, are uncomfortable receiving messages from parental figures for whatever reason. But there is a difference between removing a small factor that exists just to add a little something extra and removing an important and prominent part of the story. It would be like trying to remove Thomas and Martha Wayne being murdered from a Batman story because it could potentially upset people uncomfortable with parental death. Like, yeah, I can sympathize with not wanting to engage with that stuff, but taking it out of the work entirely is basically impossible on a practical level and ill-advised on a narrative level. And I think on the whole, this whole controversy is indicative of the natural conclusion of the mindset that exploring challenging or upsetting themes that might be too much for some people is in and of itself bad. Like, this tweet here criticizes the game for forcing people to interact with problematic content, and Even ignoring the fact that no one is making you play this game, I think the way problematic content, which in this context tends to mean offensive on an ethical level, is conflated with upsetting content is telling of the underlying mentality in a lot of these controversies. Something that causes feelings of personal discomfort is never viewed as a two-way street, a conversation between the creator and consumer, but rather a moral failing on the part of the creator. Discomfort is something done to the consumer, and it is a morally wrong thing to do, even when appropriately warned for. It reflects a reality where the mere existence of something that could cause distress is tantamount to wrongdoing on the part of the writer, and that's really concerning to me. And once again, this is a really good example of why you can't separate all conversations about how we should engage with media into supports problematic content and opposes problematic content, because, like, thinking it's absurd and unrealistic to sanitize all fiction of any topics that could potentially make a person uncomfortable or upset does not and should not automatically align you with people who think nobody should be allowed to criticize instances of racism in fandom or inappropriate treatment of minors lest they be accused of supporting murder. It worries me that statements like, it is okay and necessary for challenging and upsetting fiction that may not be for everyone to exist, have so many people scrambling to try and fit it into some fandom shipping war. Both the extreme conclusions of the anti-problematic fiction mentality and the pro-shipper mentality to me reflect concerning ways of engaging with stories, and it's something I hope we can move past in the future. I also think that some issues with the more intense end of the spectrum, where anything that could possibly make a person uncomfortable is an irredeemable moral ill, just reflects a lack of worldliness. I'm talking things like anyone who likes Loki getting together with his alternate universe self basically supports actual twins getting together, even though there is no real world moral equivalent of dating your alternate universe self, and there never has been, and there never will be. It is a non-issue. Like, the fact of the matter is that, and again, same disclaimer from earlier applies here, I am not talking about any of those things I mentioned earlier. When you read books or watch a lot of films, you are going to encounter things that make you uncomfortable. Messy relationships and explorations of trauma that don't always fit a perfect narrative. Stories where people hurt each other and forgive each other and have complicated lives. A lot of times, things in fiction are meant to be uncomfortable and are just meant to be understood, not categorically supported or categorically condemned, and that's okay. Moral judgments aren't the end-all be-all of anything a person might consume. Long story short, some of y'all straight up just need to read more books. I think some of these issues also come from, as I said earlier, the phenomenon of disinterpretation, of people needing to quickly sort any statement they see into a matrix of pre-existing belief sets that are quickly categorized as good or bad. You said you were uncomfortable with the way a psychological horror comic was marketed as a romance comic. That sounds like something an auntie would say. You are an auntie. Aunties want children to die. You want children to die. It's obviously a deeply inappropriate way to interact with other human beings, and I think the way we are constantly exposed to hundreds of people so often and so quickly that you don't see them as fully realized people with varying belief sets, but as proxies for a broader culture war meant to be interacted with only in the context of existing frameworks you fit them into, is made a lot worse by platforms like Twitter. This has especially been the case over the past year and a half, where people's real-life interactions with folks have been limited and people have been increasingly stressed and traumatized by the everything that's happening around them. The way social media and also just the world are currently set up to exist make these hostile modes of interaction a default that many people have to actively make an effort to avoid, rather than fights that people have to go out of their way to have. I don't think this fandom divide is something that's going to be healed overnight. The fact of the matter is that some of this will always boil down to irreconcilable differences of people's morality and ethics about how fiction should be engaged with and what it's for and what's okay and what's not okay. There are people involved in this whole thing who I would gladly categorize as just fundamentally in the wrong, no matter what, no matter how much nuance we introduce to the situation. But Given the massive amount of gray area in between that terms like problematic encompass, the labels of pro and anti are absolutely not doing anyone any favors here. If I could make just one singular recommendation to start the process of diminishing some of this toxicity, it would be that people abandon these labels. Or furthermore, that people abandon broad statements that could mean a massive range of things and be interpreted in hundreds of different ways and just say what they mean. When you're talking about problematic ships, what are you actually talking about? When you're talking about supporting something, what does that look like? Instead of trying to categorize every possible opinion on how we should engage with fiction and what's okay and what isn't in what context into two all or nothing camps, let's just talk about engaging with fiction. And of course, I know that a lot of this is harder on platforms like Twitter because these platforms with character limits are designed for these kinds of shortcuts and shorthands. You know, maybe we should just all delete our Twitters, honestly. All right, I need an ending line that'll rile up the pro shippers and anties so y'all can at the very least bond over disliking me. Time to go read some Zutara fanfiction, which I like. It's so much better than Raylo fanfiction, which I dislike. Peace out, everyone. I talked a lot in this video about the importance of consuming a wide variety of media, of exposing ourselves to new ideas. And one really cool way to do that is with CuriosityStream, my sponsor for this video. Essentially, CuriosityStream is this really amazing streaming service that's essentially based around addressing our desire to learn. It has thousands of cool documentaries about science, nature, history, technology, and all kinds of other fascinating things. So, for example, if you're into creativity and storytelling, things I talk about a lot in this video, you might want to check out Unraveling the Creative Mind. It talks about how creativity is this really universal human thing and goes into, from a neurological standpoint, how creativity works. I found it super interesting personally. And one thing that's especially cool about that is that CuriosityStream has actually partnered with my streaming service Nebula in order to help me and creators like Big Joel, Lindsay Ellis, Cat Black, Kento Bento, and more make exclusive content for Nebula. Basically, Nebula is a Streamy Award-nominated collaborative platform by those creators and me and tons more. What I really like about it is the way it benefits creators and audiences at the same time. Because for y'all, it lets you get early access to my videos and watch them without the ads or sponsor segments, as well as watch exclusive content that you can only get on Nebula. But it also helps support us too. Because Nebula essentially helps educational creators make videos that aren't best suited for YouTube for a variety of reasons, whether it's because of copyright issues, monetization issues, or just because it's best suited for another platform. So, for example, I have a Nebula original called Debater Theater. In Debater Theater, I basically talk about how debate skills and persuasion are all around us, and both how to recognize them in the wild and how to use those skills yourself. And I do it using examples from things like ads, movie scenes, and even award acceptance speeches. It basically lets you learn how to identify persuasive rhetoric and to get better at persuading others. If you want to watch Debater Theater or anything else on Nebula or CuriosityStream, all you have to do is go to curiositystream.com/sarahzed and use my coupon code SARAHZED at checkout. You'll not only get access to CuriosityStream, but by using my code, you'll also get an email that includes full access to Nebula.
Thank you.
On top of a big thank you to all my patrons, I would like to specially thank My Name is Jeff, Evan Grip, Tara Lederman, and Ender Cobra. Thank you so much. Also, if anybody would like this mug here that says Young, Dumb, and Full of Libel, which is, as you may know, a reference to the Homestuck legal threat video, you can just click on the merch link in my description and you can get one of these. You can also get like the Respect Women juice or some pins. You can probably find the Pro Shipper pin somewhere too, but I'm not selling those.